Many of you will want to know the key differences between the 12,000 XP and the 6,000 XP. As you can see with them side by side, the 12,000 XP is a bit larger, but it's not as much as it seems like. From left to right, we're 3 inches wider. Top to bottom, we're 8 inches taller and approximately the same depth. Now the 12,000 XP has twice as much output power. So if you're building a very large system, you could imagine saving the wall space with the 12,000 XP is preferable. The 12,000 XP also simplifies your electrical connections. If you were to imagine a parallel system with two 12,000 XPs, you have half as many connections with those two inverters versus if you had to use four of the 6,000 XPs. The wiring, the conduit, the breakers, all of those components add significant cost to the system, and the 12,000 XP is also approximately $300 cheaper, so across the board, you'll be saving. The 6000 XP has three ports for AC connection, generator, grid, and load, and they each have a 50 amp circuit breaker on them. The 12000 XP, on the other hand, has an additional port, so we have grid, generator, load, smart load, and that smart load port can be controlled by the configuration of the inverter. For the grid and generator connections, we have these mechanical lugs that use a 5mm Allen wrench. On the load port, we have a 100 amp double pole circuit breaker, and for the smart load port, we have a 63 amp double pole circuit breaker. This is a split phase inverter, so you can power your 120 and 240 volt loads from it. The smart load port can be used for loads such as electric vehicles, water heaters, and air conditioners, where you only want to turn them on to dissipate excess power. You can also use it for AC coupling microinverters if you have an existing solar array you'd like to connect in. Moving down in the wiring compartment, we have our neutral bus bar and our earth bus bar, PE standing for protective earth. To the right of the AC connections, we have inputs for our PV. There are two MPPT trackers. As you can see, one of them has the number 1 before them for the positives and negatives, and 2 before them, that is MPPT 1 and MPPT 2. These connections feed down to this isolator disconnect switch that's built in, and this switch can be activated with a simple turn of the switch. The 12000 XP does have a 100 amp bypass transfer switch. That means you could back up an entire 100 amp sub panel easily, or your entire house if you had a 100 amp service with just one inverter. On the gen port, the 12000 XP can handle up to a 21 kilowatt generator, passing through its output to your loads connected to the load terminal, and it can also charge the battery with up to 250 amps DC. Moving over to the left-hand side of the inverter, we have a green terminal block here. These are our various different connections for outputs such as generator stop-start. This would be a two-wire start signal. We also have the RSD input for an emergency stop button and a 12-volt and ground output for a rapid shutdown transmitter. Moving up, we have two parallel ports. This is for connecting multiple inverters together. Up to 6 units can be stacked in parallel. There are also two little dip switches in here, and I want to point these out specifically because if you're stacking multiple inverters, you'll need to set these, and I just want to make sure you're aware of where they are. The other two ports on top are not used. There is an input here for a battery temperature connection if you're using lead acid batteries and need temperature compensation. And then we have the battery communication port. It supports RS-485 and CAN bus communication, and there are various pins used depending on which protocol you're using. This inverter also supports total rapid shutdown when using EG4 batteries that have these shunt trip circuit breakers on them. The terminals on the 12000 XP are quite different from the 6000 XP. There are two compression lugs included, both on the positive and the negative terminal. My favorite part about this is you have choices, unlike something like the 18K PV. These can simply be removed with a 10mm screwdriver or wrench, and now you have the perfect means to put a crimped on lug, such as a ring terminal, right onto the same connection. Just like that. Now what fun would this be if we didn't take it apart? This actually gives quite a bit more clarity on a couple other sections of this inverter. With that cover removed, it is apparently obvious what is going on with the PV terminals. As you can see on the right, we have two connections for the second tracker and two more connections for the first one, and the terminal blocks are just jumpered over to put our solar strings in parallel. This can be done either here at the inverter, or if it's more convenient and your solar array is some distance away, you can also make your parallel connections at the solar array. Additionally, for the PV, there is an arc fault detector tucked away here in the back of the inverter. We're set up now to measure the idle consumption of this inverter. Down here on the bottom of the bench, I have one of EG4's LifePower 4V2 batteries, and that is our source of power. It is running up here on top, flowing through my Fluke 287 digital multimeter. This is to measure the current the inverter draws, and we have the voltage reading here on the Fluke 117. On most inverters, you'll see a steady current draw. However, on this one, I see a slightly varying current draw. So I went ahead and put my 287 into min-max average mode. And if I reset the averaging, it will give us our minimum amount of current and our maximum amount of current. I'm also doing the same thing on the Fluke 117, because if you see, the varying current from the battery is also causing the voltage to vary. So if we use average mode, it's going to give us the most accurate reading here. And you can see now that we have 53.6 volts and an average current of 1.95 amps. We can use those for our idle consumption calculations. That gives us 104.52 watts. We've now moved the battery over to the 6000 XP and we're going to do the same test. Now, this one, the current is not changing as much, and as a result, neither is the voltage. But I'm still going to put it into average mode. That way we get apples to apples comparison. I'm going to reset the averaging here on the Fluke 287, and we can see at 53.5 volts, we have about an average of 1.28 amps. So if we multiply that out, that gives us 67 watts of idle consumption, and if we multiply that by 2 for 2 inverters, that gives us 135 watts of idle consumption, substantially more than the 12000 XP. So that proves the 12000 XP is more efficient at idle. There are a couple of settings in both inverters where you can program them to turn off at certain times to save you power. This test is with a constant AC output and no eco mode enabled. While this is my favorite part, I love opening up the inverters. I have to say, don't do this at home. It will void your warranty, unfortunately. However, I'm going to show you everything I possibly can about this. So let's dig in. There are some screws that hold this front cover on, and boy, is this front cover heavy. This is beautiful inside. Let's get some close-ups. Now for reference, this unit is on because I've been doing some probing around in here. Don't ever take the top cover off the unit with it on. So while this does look incredibly complicated, this is very common for this type of all-in-one high-frequency inverter. In the top left corner here, our 48-volt DC battery bank connects on, and we immediately go into an H-bridge up here. This is going to chop up the 48 volts DC into a very high frequency AC. Usually most inverters are around 20 kilohertz here. It then runs through these coils here, and these are typically transformers. Now, I don't have the full engineering docs of this inverter, so what I'm mentioning is based off my experience and what I've seen in previous inverters. Typically, this is where your voltage gets stepped up to a high voltage before it gets rectified to DC. And I don't see exactly where the rectifier is here, but what I do know is that I can probe on these wires right here, and I have 380 volts DC. So all of that complication gets pretty simple because right here there are three wires, a black, blue, and red wire. This is our high voltage DC bus. Now, before our high voltage DC bus goes to the AC inverter, we add on our PV wire. So there are four wires up here in the top right coming from our PV inputs. And this is where that solar power is chopped up, brought to the correct voltage for the high voltage bus. And then, like I mentioned, it goes down to the inverter section of the inverter. These round red things here are chokes. So essentially, they are what filters out any interference from going back to either your DC bus or back to your PV array. Remember, I mentioned this is operating at about 20 kilohertz. You wouldn't want that kind of interference affecting other devices in your system, so that's why these exist to filter that out. As we continue to flow through the inverter, we have a large high voltage DC capacitor bank here. This, like I mentioned, is operating at about 380 volts DC. This smooths out the DC bus and helps the inverter with its surge capacity before the devices attached to these two heat sinks chop it up and turn it back into AC, at which point it runs through another set of inductors to filter it out before it gets into this area here, which I know is hard to see. This section is all of your transfer switches for the generator, smart loads port, load, and grid connection. Other than that, there is a board in here on its side. This is the main control board, and this is what drives all of the inverter boards, transfer switches, front control panel, and the communication board down in the wiring compartment of the inverter. A common judge these days for the quality of an inverter is if the circuit boards are conformal coated. These circuit boards are conformal coated. That's important because there are fans on the right-hand side of the inverter that push the heat from the right-hand side to the left, and the conformal coating just makes sure dust or moisture does not cause any damage to this inverter. So to summarize our key differences between the 12,000 XP and just two of the 6,000 XPs are that we could take in more solar input. We have the additional smart load port. One inverter uses less idle consumption than two inverters. And it will definitely save you space on the wall and reduce the complication of wiring up if you plan to do multiple inverters in parallel. I hope you found today's video helpful and informative. We make plenty of videos, so feel free to check out our channel. And if you're interested in purchasing any EG4 products, we are a full-service distributor. We'll put links to the products down in the description. And you're always welcome to reach out to us if you have questions. We'll put that contact information in the description as well. I want to say thank you so much for watching, and we'll see you guys in the next video.